Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today on the program, Bryan Lynn has a report on the spread of bird flu around the world. Then Mario Ritter Jr. and Anna Matteo present this week's education report. Finally, we hear the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
different versions of bird flu have been spreading around the world in recent years. The virus, officially known as H5N1, is believed to have killed millions of wild and domestic birds worldwide. Some other animals have also been infected. The virus infected a very small number of people as well, but H5N1 largely has remained outside the human population. Most of the few human cases involved direct contact between people and infected birds. Reuters news agency recently explored areas of the world where versions of H5N1 have infected humans. In the United States, the first known cases of infected dairy cows happened in Texas in March. Currently, dairy cows grouped in at least 12 states have been affected. The U.S. Agriculture Department has said tests so far suggest the virus identified in cows is the same H5N1 found to have infected wild birds and farm birds, also called poultry. 4 dairy workers who tested positive for the virus this year showed only minor signs of sickness, such as conjunctivitis, an eye condition. Officials from the European Food Safety Agency, EFSA, said in a report the H5N1 virus spreading in the U.S. is related to a version only identified in North America so far. The World Health Organization, WHO, said on June 5th that a resident of Mexico died with the first known cases of H5N2 bird flu in humans. Mexico's government disputed that cause of death, saying instead the person died of another sickness. Officials said the person had no known contact with animals. On June 7th, the WHO said a child reported by Australia to have H5N1 had traveled to Kolkata, India. Genetic testing showed the virus was a version of H5N1. That version was known to have been spreading in Southeast Asia and has been identified in previous human infections and in poultry. Separately, Australia is dealing with 3 outbreaks of different bird flu versions on poultry farms. These include H7N3, H7N8, and H7N9. Officials said those versions likely arrived on farms through wild birds. In India, the WHO reported a case of human infection with bird flu on June 11th. It was caused by the H9N2 version in a 4-year-old child in the eastern Indian state of West Bengal. The agency said it was the second human infection of H9N2 bird flu from India following a case in 2019. The H9N2 virus generally only causes mild sickness, but the WHO said further human cases could happen because this version is one of the most common at poultry farms in different areas. In March, Vietnam reported a 21-year-old student had died from the H5N1 virus. He had no existing medical conditions. But officials said the student had had contact with wild birds from hunting a couple of weeks before signs of sickness appeared. No contact with dead or sick poultry was reported at the time. The EFSA said Vietnam also reported an outbreak of H9N2 in a 37-year-old man. Cambodia has reported 5 human cases of H5N1 as of June 20th. This year, China has identified human cases caused by the H5N6, H9N2, and H10N3 versions. 2 deaths were reported with H5N6 cases in the country's Fujian province. The EFSA said both individuals had contact with household poultry before they showed signs of sickness. The case of H10N3 bird flu was the 3rd one ever reported worldwide. Germany reported a rare outbreak of H7N5 bird flu on a farm in a western part of the country near the border with the Netherlands. The case was identified July 4th by the World Organization for Animal Health. The group said it was the first outbreak anywhere of H7N5 on the group's public records. I'm Bryan Lynn.
A new study says that Americans have increasing questions about the value and cost of a college education. Most of the people taking part in the study felt that higher education in the U.S. is headed in the wrong direction. Gallup and the Lumina Foundation carried out the study. It found that only 36% of adults said they had a great deal or quite a lot of confidence in higher education. That confidence level has decreased steadily from 57% in 2015. That was the first year in which Gallup measured confidence in higher education. The decline is seen in all subgroups of people, including sex, age, and political ties. Among Republican Party members in the study, the number of people with high confidence in higher education has dropped 36 percentage points over the last 10 years. That is far more than for Democratic Party members or independents.
Some of the opinions in the study might show concerns about the high cost of college and how race and other subjects are taught. 59-year-old Randy Hill is a registered Republican in Connecticut and a driver for a car service. He told the Associated Press, "It's so expensive, and I don't think colleges are teaching people what they need to get a job." Hill said his nephew plans to do a welding apprenticeship after high school, instead of going to college. The June 2024 study found that 36% of adults feel strong confidence in higher education. That percentage is unchanged from the year before. But the researchers said they were concerned that fewer Americans were saying that they had some confidence, and more were reporting very little or none. This year's findings show almost as many people have little or no confidence, 32%, as those with high confidence.
Experts say that fewer college graduates could worsen labor shortages in fields from healthcare to information technology. For those who do not go to college, it often means lower lifetime earnings. Georgetown University's Center on Education and the Workforce said lifetime earnings for those without a bachelor's degree could be 75% less than for those with a degree. The center also said that during an economic downturn, those without college degrees are more likely to lose their jobs. Courtney Brown is a vice president at Lumina, an education nonprofit group. It aims to increase the number of students who seek education beyond high school. She said, "What's shocking to me is that the people who have low or no confidence is actually increasing." This year's study added new, detailed questions in an effort to understand why confidence is shrinking. Almost one-third of people in the study said college is too expensive. About 25% thought students are not getting the right education or taught what they need to succeed. The study did not ask about the protests against the war in Gaza this year that divided many college communities. But people who took part said they had concerns about indoctrination, political bias, and that colleges are too liberal. Among those who said they lack confidence in college, 41% said political activity was a reason. 67% of adults in the study said colleges are headed in the wrong direction. That is more than two times higher than the 31% who think that colleges are going in the right direction. Gallup noted that when people express confidence in higher education, they are thinking of four-year colleges. But the study found that more people have confidence in two-year community colleges. 49% of adults said they have a great deal or quite a lot of confidence in two-year programs, compared with 33% of Americans who feel that way about four-year colleges.
California college student Kristen Freeman said she understands why. "It's about saving money. That's why I went to a two-year. It's more bang for your buck," said Freeman, who is a 22-year-old sociology major at Diablo Valley Community College. She plans to go to San Jose State University for the final 2 years of college. Freeman said she understands the concerns about indoctrination and whether college prepares students for life and work. but she feels the only way to change structural problems is from the inside. I am learning about the world around me and developing useful skills in critical thinking, Freeman said. I think higher education can give students the spark to want to change the system.
I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
And I'm Anna Matteo.
Mario Ritter Jr. joins me now to talk more about this week's education report. Hi, Mario. Welcome.
Thank you, Ashley. It's nice to be here today.
A recent public opinion study found that most people who took part believe higher education in the U.S. is going in the wrong direction. Let's talk about some key terms we heard in this week's report. First, one of the biggest complaints about college was that it is too expensive. So, what is the difference between the words costly and expensive?
The adjectives costly and expensive can be used interchangeably in most cases. However, expensive is used to describe something with a high financial price. The word costly describes any sort of loss related to a transaction or exchange. So, a cost can refer to something other than money. Things like labor, time, and emotions can all be costs. So, something that is expensive is costly, but something that is costly isn't necessarily high in financial price.
There was also an idiomatic expression that we heard, more bang for your buck. Our listeners might be wondering what this means. Can you explain it a little?
Sure, Ashley. A buck is an informal word for a dollar. More bang for your buck means to get the biggest effect for the lowest cost. In the story, the student was saying that by going to a community college for 2 years, she was getting the most for the money she was spending. This idiom often expresses a feeling that people have about spending, which is, there must be a good value attached to a cost, and a high financial price does not always mean there is value in something. I'm wondering if this was ever on your VOA Learning English program, English in a Minute.
I will have to look that up. We've done a lot. Well, thanks so much for being here, Mario, and thanks for that report.
You're welcome, Ashley. It's always nice to talk with you.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Andrew Smith, and I'm joined by Dr. Jill Robbins. Hi, Jill.
Hey, Andrew.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello. My name is Anna Matteo.
Today's lesson is going to be a mix. We'll teach you some useful expressions, explain something we call logical connectors, which are special words for connecting phrases, and we'll revisit the present perfect tense by focusing on the word since.
And we're basing all of this on Lesson 15 of Level 2, of the Let's Learn English series. You know, Jill, we've talked about the present perfect several times in these podcast lessons.
That's right. We've talked about it ever since we looked at Lesson 48 from Level 1 of the series. But it's so important, I think we should talk about it again.
I do too. And we use the present perfect a lot in English. So it makes sense that we are revisiting it. We use the word since to refer to a specific time that something began in the past, but is continuing now.
Let's hear the example from Lesson 15 of Level 2. Anna and her friend Penelope are doing a kind of exercise called speed walking. You keep one foot on the ground at all times, but you try to move as quickly as you can. You swing your arms in a special way, too, that looks a little like chicken's wings.
It is a little funny looking. Let's listen.
Penelope, even though we both love speed walking, can we slow down a bit?
No way. I think because I'm walking with you, I'm walking faster.
Come on, Penelope. Let's take a break. We've been speed walking since 8 a.m. You're so competitive. You even wore your medals.
You brought your trophies? You're out of shape. When we were little girls, we could speed walk all day.
Hey, wait for me. You know the speed walking rules. If both feet leave the ground, it's running. You ran.
Did you hear when Anna used the word since and the present perfect tense? Here it is again.
Come on, Penelope. Let's take a break. We've been speed walking since 8 a.m.
We should also remind our listeners that the word since actually has two meanings. Informally, it can mean the same thing as because.
Right. Like we could say, since it's getting dark outside, we should go home.
Anna wants a break from her speed walking and gets some advice about exercise from Penelope.
Whew, that was great.
Wow, Penelope, you're still really fast. Since I've been working in an office, my speed walking has been much slower.
You are slower, Anna. Maybe you should hire a personal trainer.
That will be great, as long as the trainer understands speed walking.
Try this company. After you fill out an online application, they will match you to the perfect trainer.
As soon as I get home, I'll do it. Thanks.
Hopefully the trainer will help Anna in her speed walking. But let's listen one more time to an example with the word since and the present perfect tense.
Since I've been working in an office, my speed walking has been much slower.
Here, a listener might get confused and think Anna is using the word since to mean the word because. But in a situation like this, where there seems to be two possible meanings, the speaker is probably just talking about what happens after a particular time. If they are not talking about time, they will usually say the word because, if that is what they mean.
Listeners, we know that might be a lot to understand. The good news is you can always go back and listen to that explanation again.
Yes, you can. That's a good idea. Okay, now let's hear what happens to Anna when she meets her new personal trainer.
Hi, are you my trainer?
If you're Anna, then I'm your trainer, Alaskan Owlbear. Because I'm from the Alaskan wilderness, I'm skilled in all outdoor activities of the wild.
That's great, but what about speed walking?
Speed walking? That's funny. Since I've been living in the city, I've combined wilderness training with a city workout. I call it Call of the Wild Parkour.
Okay, but seriously, when do we speed walk?
Your application did not say how funny you are.
No, but it did say that I'm a speed walker. Did you read it? Forget it. We'll have to cancel.
Why?
We can't train today because it's too cold and too windy.
No way. No pain, no gain. When you exercise in really cold weather, you feel alive.
Really? Because right now I just feel cold.
You're so funny, but seriously, after our training, you will be ready for any extreme physical challenge. Let's get started. Anna, even though you're trying really hard, you're really bad at Call of the Wild parkour!
And if you're wondering why Anna's trainer makes that extra sound when he says parkour, it's because in the video, he's imitating a wolf, a wild animal.
Anna is not happy with her new trainer because he's not helping her with her speed walking. Instead, he tries to teach her parkour, which is running, jumping, and climbing over objects, usually in the city. However, he does say that Anna is trying hard. And this is where you can hear a logical connector with the words even though.
Anna, even though you're trying really hard, you're really bad at Call of the Wild parkour!
We use the words even though to connect one statement with another unexpected, surprising, or contrasting statement.
For example, I might say, even though it's cold outside, I'm not going to wear my jacket.
And now, here's a few more expressions from Lesson 15 of Level 2. Anna's trainer says he is skilled in all outdoor activities in the wild.
We can be skilled in or skilled at something. To have skill or be skilled means to be very good at doing something. We can use the preposition in or the preposition at after the word skilled.
Another expression Anna's trainer says is, no pain, no gain. That means if you don't work extra hard and maybe feel some discomfort, you will not make the changes and improvement you need. This phrase is used a lot when we talk about exercise and getting in good physical shape.
There's one more kind of connecting phrase we can hear in Lesson 15 as well. Listen to Penelope and Anna again.
You are slower, Anna. Maybe you should hire a personal trainer.
That will be great, as long as the trainer understands speed walking.
When Anna says, as long as, she is not talking about time. Instead, the phrase, as long as, means we want something only if certain conditions or other situations happen. In this case, Anna only wants the trainer if he helps her with speed walking.
Well, let's see if he does ever help her.
Anna, even though you're trying really hard, you're really bad at Call of the Wild parkour!
I'm bad at Call of the Wild parkour because I don't want to do Call of the Wild parkour! I'm a speed walker. It's what I do. It's part of who I am.
Why didn't you say something?
I did. Several times. You thought I was joking.
Now I understand. Anna, I can help you. If you follow my advice, I'll put the speed back in your speed walk. Go, Anna! Go!
At the end, Anna does get the help she wanted.
And we hope you've gotten the help you wanted by listening to the lesson of the day.
And remember, as long as you keep listening and studying, your English will keep improving.
And even though it can sometimes be difficult, try to speak English as much as you can.
Remember, no pain, no gain.
That's right. Well, we've come to the end of today's lesson. Thanks for listening. Remember, you can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.